Hi, I'm Neil Hartman, Senior Director for the Center for Sports Communication and Social Impact. In the next 60 seconds, I'm going to tell you how internships lead to jobs for our sports communication and media students. Walking through Chase Fieldhouse, you'll see nothing but Rowan students. This is the third year of our partnership with the Delaware Bluecoats and the Wilmington Blue Rocks. It gives our students immense opportunities. They're working in game operations, broadcast, production. For the Sports Communication and Media program, there's nothing better than having the experience of broadcasting a professional basketball or baseball game to put it on your resume and show potential employers that you can compete and broadcast at this level. Just this spring, the Wilmington Blue Rocks will hire 3 full-time Rowan students who have yet to graduate. So at the end of their internship, these students are ready to go into the workplace, and employers are hiring Rowan students.
Figure, look at that. Oh, look at that. Look at that. Oh, would you look at that? Just look at it. Just look at it.
Yeah.
What I tell interns now is if you're an intern, act like a coordinator. And if you're a coordinator, act like a manager. If you're a manager, act like a director, and so on and so forth. Because that'll show that you're ready for the next thing. If you're an intern that walks in and creates work for your boss to find work for you, to me, that's not a good intern. Now, there's a level of that when you first start. Course, show you the ropes, train you, whatever. But if you're getting into like weeks, months into the internship, and you're still walking in going, okay, what do you want me to do? That's not a helpful intern. And I think if the successful interns pick stuff up that they see that makes everyone else's job easier rather than everyone else's job harder, trying to think of stuff for you to do.
So we run a lot of social media ads. We spend a lot of money running targeted Facebook ads. And obviously those things, they take research, they take developing, they take retargeting, they take advertising campaign development. And that's something that as an intern, you would be involved with along the way. So it's not something where we'd be like, here's your budget, go run it and make that money come back to us. It's not going to just throw you into the deep waters, but it's something that you would be able to be a part of. And that hopefully you can gain those skills throughout your time, helping out with those campaigns and those budgets and what it is that we do, that by the end of it, it's something that you could do on your own. And if you were to stay with us or go to another company, you can say that I have experience running campaigns. I've developed them. I've led them. I've worked on a project management with creative. And at the end of it, here's the ROI that my campaign's got. You'll be able to have something to show for it. I think Quentin could probably attest to this. It's like at the beginning, we're going to show you a lot of like, this is how we do it. But as time goes on, it's like, now you show us how you do it. And that's what we want to get to.
If you love what you do, if you have a joy in what you do, there's really no hard part.
So I would be, you know, watching 3 games at once, and I might be like a Yankees-Red Sox game. I would be live tweeting for the Yankees and the Red Sox. And you can imagine how nerve-wracking that must be.
10 copies of the same cassette, and I sent them out to every AA, single-A, rookie ball team.
One of the few women to ever actually be color analyst for a college football game.
What is this age? Just say yes to everything.
Yeah, it's a Philadelphia fan. You love that.
Every time I have an opportunity to produce a live stream, it's an opportunity to show the world the work that I can do.
You've been at many clubhouses. What player has had the best music taste?
Best music taste? I think Kenny Lofton might be the best when I was playing with him with the Cleveland Indians. Plus, he had a crush on Janet Jackson. He had his poster in his locker. Big crush on her.
Seeds or gum?
Seeds now. I do seeds even now.
What's your favorite flavor?
I like ranch seeds. I'm big ranch.
And what's your favorite game that you ever called as a broadcaster?
Oh my goodness. That's hard to think about, but I've just really enjoyed anytime we have comeback wins. Those are the ones I love. I love to listen to Tom McCarthy call a home run, make home run calls, and I sometimes have to watch myself for interjecting a little too early. Like, I get kind of excited, a little like Michael Bourne does sometimes when he does it on radio.
I had a couple of like off-campus jobs, and I was a senior, and one of my professors said, listen, a kid has backed out of a paid internship at the Herald Journal covering high schools. Are you interested? I was like, are you crazy? Of course I am. The guy who was covering high schools as a full-time job was getting a promotion. So they had a slot that they needed to fill. And I did a good enough job as one of the paid interns there to walk into his job. If you impress these people, I mean, you're not there to get water. You're there to do a job. And the more you're prepared, the more you invest, and the more that you impress upon them that you can not just learn quickly, but think on your feet and be aggressive and assertive. They don't care about the mistakes. They care about the energy. They care about your intelligence. They care about your ability. It can turn into a job or a job, tangential, parallel to what they're doing, because everybody knows somebody, right?
So the one thing I would say about sports is the longer you're in this industry, and I said this when I first started, that I wanted to get to a point where your next job sort of finds you, because you're all in a situation, right, where applying for internships, applying for jobs, it's a full-time job to do that. And it's a lot of work. So you get to the point in this career where you have enough relationships where you sort of can navigate and grow and move. And that's essentially what happened for me at Playfly. I was working for another events company, and we were doing a deal with Playfly. And Playfly basically decided, we don't really want to do the deal. We don't want to work. We were working on a World Long Drive event together. They basically decided, we don't really want to do the event. And they called me afterwards and said, we don't really want to do that, but do you want to come do events over here? And it was a great opportunity to start an events division at a different company with a lot of resources. So I made the jump.
I think the best way to kind of move your resume to the top, to kind of get through all the clutter and the noise, is to really concentrate on becoming an expert at what you want to do. When we're interviewing someone, you know, one of the questions I ask, like if it's a group of us, what made you want to apply for this position? And there's two answers that make me cringe if I get this. It's either I just want to work in sports, or I've always been a huge Eagles fan. What I look for is someone who truly enjoys doing PR, or someone who truly enjoys doing mass media, or someone who likes working behind the camera. If you really refine your craft that way, your resume is going to speak for itself. If you know specifically what you want to do, if you feel like PR is your avenue, refine that as much as you can, be an expert at that craft, and then pursue, you know, whatever team or industry or league you want to work in, and everything else will fall in place.
What was the biggest transition from player to analyst?
It's understanding that I wasn't a player no more, that I'm an analyst, that I'm in the media now. So I think for me, that was the biggest thing for me to understand that part and accept that part. And that's a hard pill to swallow once you take that jersey off.
So I wear the Super Bowl ring, as you probably few of you noticed if you're looking. And everyone says, oh, you got the ring because you're a former player. Absolutely not. I got this ring because I was on the committee, the selection committee. There were seven of us that hired Doug Peterson. And it was extraordinary. It was one of the most extraordinary experiences I've ever had in my life. And these weren't like, let's sit here for 15 minutes. They were 12-hour interviews. We'd start at 8 in the morning, go to 8 at night or 9 at night. And I was really thankful to Jeffrey Lurie and Howie Roseman, Don Smolinski, and Tom Donahoe. They let me ask a lot of the football questions. Two-minute offense, coming-out offense, red zone offense, go-zone offense. How are you going to do it? Formation, what's your philosophy? They let me handle a lot of it. I'm deeply indebted they put me on that group. So after we did all the interviews and we had decided that Doug Peterson was going to be the coach, we all said, let's take a picture. I said, well, I'm going to save this picture because after we win the Super Bowl, I want a ring. The minute the Eagles won the Super Bowl, the next day, I should say, I sent that picture to Jeffrey. I said, I expect my ring. And he came through.
Since we was on, I dreamed it all. Ever since I was young, they said I won't mean nothing. Now they always say congratulations. Work so hard.